This is a very important question to get right, because it was absolutely key for me. When our foundation first started up, it was focused on reproductive health. That was the main thing we did, because I thought, you know, population growth in poor countries is the biggest problem they face. You've got to help mothers who want to limit family size have the tools and education to do that. And I thought that's the only thing that really counts. Well, then I came across articles that showed that the key thing you can do to reduce population growth is actually improve health. And that sounds paradoxical. You think, okay, better health means more kids, not less kids. Well, in fact, what parents are doing is they're trying to have two kids survive to adulthood to take care of them. And so the more disease burden there is, the more kids they have to have that high probability. So there's a perfect correlation that as you improve health, within a half generation, the population growth rate goes down. In fact, Hans Rosling here at this conference, in two of my favorite speeches, actually showed that unbelievable correlation that population growth has gone down. Today, where is there high population growth? It's in the places with the worst health conditions, northern Nigeria, northern India. And so the two problems go exactly hand in hand. If we improve health rapidly, we will get the peak population to be as much as a billion below the current expected peak. That is about 8.3 billion versus 9.3.
One last question. I read a Washington Times article many years ago where you had a comment about the organization, and then now it's been in the Wall Street Journal, it's been in a lot of different newspapers, and that's the Bohemian Grove. And back in, what was it, 1996, when you joined as a Clinton advisor, the Republicans were criticizing you. Oh, what about Bohemian Grove? And then you countered, them by saying, "Hey, I don't run around in the woods naked." What did that mean?
Here is the before mentioned Washington Times article where he said, "I didn't run around naked like they do."
I don't know what quote you're referring to. I'm not aware of any quote like that. I am a happy member of the Bohemian Grove. I like the folks who come there, and it's really inappropriate for me to talk about the group beyond that. Thank you.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
Frankly, I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about.
Really?
That's right.
Well, I'm Alex Jones, and I snuck in there in 2000. I'm the guy that blew it wide open
and got the video. It's been on national TV.
Well, I disrespect you for that.
You do?
I do.
But it's a lot of big public officials going in there. Don't we deserve to know?
You took an, I don't know anything about you, and I don't know anything about your film. But if you go in there with an understanding, you violated that understanding by releasing that film, and I don't respect you for that.
Really? But you, we have public officials.
You took an understanding when you went in there that you would not do that film. And you did you have an understanding when you went in there?
No.
Did you crash it?
Yes.
Yeah, and it has no trespassing signs there too, doesn't it?
No, they put them up after.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, sir. I've been there before. I know what the circumstances are, and I'm sorry you violated the understandings. That was not a gentlemanly thing to do.
But what about the ritual? Is the ritual gentlemanly?
Sir, everything. I don't owe you this comment.
I know.
You have. This is what's called ambush journalism, and I disrespect you for that as well. So thank you and goodbye.
You ever been in the ritual?
That's none of your damn business.
Today, our nation saw evil, the very worst of human nature.
They had exactly the same agenda, and that was for bringing in this new world order. I heard George Bush talking at that time. He was talking to Bill Clinton, and I've since photographically recorded it and wrote a verbatim in our book, that when the American people became disillusioned with Republicans leading them into the new world order, that Bill Clinton, as a Democrat, was going to be put into the office of president. This was decided in 1984. Actually, I'd heard about it even prior to that. But that, as of 1984, they were already discussing it as an absolute fact.
The CIA is carrying out mind control on countless numbers of unwitting American victims. And he even went so far as to say the basic methods that they use in this mind control: hypnosis, drugs, and torture.
Three-part policy that they had adopted there. The second one was to find a way of being able to get total control of people's minds. And that would be done by taking hypnotism out of the realm of the occult and introduce it as a new science for the benefit of mankind.
Once I realized I had met an honest, genuine, high-level Freemason who told me there were 13 levels of Freemason above the 33rd degree, and that these people were God. There was no God, they were God. So I asked them about their plans to kill people, and they said, yes, there are too many people on the planet. We need to get rid of several billion. And war doesn't seem to work, so we're going to use disease and starvation.
He knew what was happening, and he attempted to warn us when he left office. He told us, quite bluntly and in no uncertain terms, to beware of the military-industrial complex. And who is the military-industrial complex? It is the members of the Council on Foreign Relations, and since the inception of the Trilateral Commission as well. Was made up of the Executive Committee of the Council on Foreign Relations. Now, it is extremely significant that you understand that the first six members from the government, along with President Eisenhower, were also members and longtime members of the Council on Foreign Relations. They believed in that organization. They believed in its goals, which was one world government.
Number 15, create industrial depression and financial panic, unemployment, hunger, shortage of food. Use this to control the masses or the mobs, and use the mobs to wipe out all those who dare to stand in the way. Well, I'll tell you right now, every expert I've talked to is talking about food shortage. And it's coming, I'm convinced.
My administration will not talk about how we gather intelligence, if we gather intelligence, and what the intelligence says. I will not discuss. We will not discuss. It's important for us to not reveal how we collect information. That's what the enemy wants.
And you have no evidence that the government's behind 9/11, and I frankly think it's an awful thing to allege, considering it's not true and you haven't proved that it is. It's totally implausible. Like, we would report that if that were true.
Because these guys own our government. They print our money, and they own not only the government, but they own you. You are their property. So, in other words, these guys print the money, they run the country, and they own you, and they own everything around it. And so they make the laws, And that's why they can decide who can kill who and who can get away with who and who can get away with whatever, because they make the laws and they decide.
On that day, what did the president say to you?
The president, in a very intimidating way, left us, me and my staff, with the clear indication that he wanted us to come back with the word that there was an Iraqi hand behind 9/11, because they had been planning to do something about Iraq from before the time they came into office.
Did he ask about any other nations other than Iraq?
No, not at all. It was Iraq, Saddam, find out, get back to me.
And were his questions more about Iraq than about Al-Qaeda?
Absolutely. Absolutely. He didn't ask me about Al-Qaeda. And we said, but Iraq had nothing to do with this. And that didn't seem to make much difference.
And we'll continue to work together to achieve peace. That's what we want, freedom and peace.
Look at the Council on Foreign Relations. Many members, in fact, the majority, never serve on the executive committees. They never go through any initiation of any kind. They are, in fact, the power base and are used to gain a consensus of opinion. The majority are not really members, but are made to feel as if they are. In reality, they are being used and are unwilling or unable to understand. They may have been or may be members of the Christian or Jewish religion, but that is only to further their own ends. They are and always have been Luciferian and internationalist. They give allegiance to no particular nation, although they have used, on occasion, nationalism to further their causes. Their only concern is to gain greater economic and political power. The ultimate objective of the leaders of both groups is identical. They are determined to win for themselves undisputed control of the wealth, natural resources, and manpower of the entire planet. They intend to turn the world into their conception of a Luciferian totalitarian socialist state. You have just learned one, but only one, of the great mystery.
The people who are running this country from behind the scenes do not care a thing about Americans or bloodshed anywhere.
I think we're going to awaken one day to find out that we've all been too relaxed and entertained and watching television and being entertained with all the cares of life, never realizing what is going on in this country.
In the secret, ladies and gentlemen, they are at least, very bare minimum, 50 to 100 years ahead, beyond what you can even imagine.
Something that the old man said many years ago. He said that conspiracies are able to deal with just about anything. They can buy you off, they can shoot you, they can deal you in just about any way they want.
Well, they own the money system.
Right, but the one thing he said they cannot deal with is exposure. No conspiracy can deal with exposure. Once the truth is out and the people understand, then they have problems. And I am saying that the power of any government is in people. And a classic example of that, how would you like to go to a summit with the King of America and the King of China, and you being the King of Fredonia with 500 subjects? You might as well stay home, because the power of a king is in how many people are in his kingdom. So the point I'm making here is that there is a tremendous power in the hands of the people of America if they would just wake up, because they are the power of this country. The people decide what will happen, and the people have allowed these things to happen and allow them to continue to go their way and be entertained, and that is the problem that we're facing, not only with the religious and political leaders that are part of this, but the real problem is the people have allowed it to happen.
Well, in the land of the blind, the one eye is king. Terry Cook, you came on strong and heavy just a few years ago, and you become the expert on this new computer chip that's supposed to go in the back of the hand. It all relates to this Council on Foreign Relations group, the Bilderbergers, the Club of Rome, this oligarchy who's trying to bring it all about.
That's right. Anthony, let's make a very complex issue
as simple as possible for the people's benefit. The New World Order really consists of three aspects. There is a New World political system that everyone today is calling the New World Order. As well as that, there is an economic plan for the New World Order. And that is called the New World Economic Order. In addition to those two items, there's a third plan for religion. You see, the planners of the world know that men need a religion of some kind, even if it's a false one. So they have a plan to give us a new age world global occultic religion. So really, there's three aspects to this New World Order. A New World Economic Order, in which a computer chip will be injected into our hands or foreheads as a means to track, control, and identify us, and will also be used to make our purchases and scan its.
Well, they've already put the program in Los Angeles. In fact, a trilateralist named Mayor Bradley, Uncle Tom Bradley, was responsible for putting this in dogs.
Right.
And your children will be considered like animals. Like animals, and operating through the Council on Foreign Relations, through the Trilateral Commission, through the Club of Rome, through Global 2000, which wants to reduce the population of the planet by, 25%. That's 1,250,000,000 people have to be exterminated by the year 2000.
Well, they can do that.
So
they
essentially,
this
Illuminati, then, is the group of men who control not only all the money on the planet through all the world banks and the Federal Reserve and so on, but they control essentially all the governments. And so these men are planning to bring about a global form of government that's unique in all history. It's a total enslaving system of world communism and fascism, controlled by a hierarchy in Europe that Anthony calls what? The oligarchy.
Well, no, I call it the evilarchy.
The evilarchy.
The oligarchy of evil.
So these men are satanically inspired, and of course we get that term from the Bible, which means the devil. They're satanically inspired to bring about a global form of government to every nation on earth.
Now on the new dimes, you will see it has been transplanted a torch instead of the old fasci, because fascism was used at one time to prepare the world for New World Order. Now the New World Order is in place. That's why on the dollar bill it says Nova Ordo Seclorum is New Order of the World, but at the top of the pyramid on the back of the dollar bill is Anuit Coeptus, which in Latin means our enterprise or our project has been crowned with success. So the point I want to make is that on the back of the American dime today, anyone can look at the back of the dime and see the torch of illumination, which is carried in the Olympics, which is the torch that the Statue of Liberty carries. It is the torch of the Illuminati who are illuminated.
But what we need to do is explain this term New World Order, because do you realize how few people out there have actually heard George Bush and others use this occultic phrase that we're talking about, the New World Order? George Bush said it well over 200 times, and if you ask the average person on the street if they even heard it once, they'll answer no.
When Hitler talked about a 1,000-year Reich, and Bush talks about 1,000 points of light, there's more than just a small similarity. They are one and the same. We're talking about a Fourth Reich, the rich, and that's what we're talking about with the New World Order. They want it all. And that fiat funny money that we use isn't money at all. It's debt in the privately owned Federal Reserve.
That's
the privately owned Federal Reserve is neither federal nor a reserve. It's private.
That's right.
A private banking institution which draining us. It's like America is an invalid in the hospital and dying, and they're putting up an IV bleed to bleed us of the remaining blood that we have to bring us down to the very bottom.
That's absolutely correct, Anthony. And since you brought up the Federal Reserve, let's look at the back of our dollar bill and analyze the symbol of the Illuminati. That's what this is, folks. It's also a Masonic symbol, but it's the symbol of the Illuminati, which controls, as Anthony said, all your money through the Federal Reserve, all the U.S. government money, and through other world banks, all the world's money. But this is their symbol, and this is basically the all-seeing eye of Lucifer, Satan, the devil. And what this inscription means here is announcing the birth of the satanic New World Order government. And Jordan, when was this placed on our dollar bill, and by whom, and what was the story?
Well, it was placed in 1935, I think it was, originally on the dollar bill. But what I wanted to draw attention to is the fact that it's an Egyptian pyramid. And you had better look at the idea of why an Egyptian pyramid is on an American dollar bill.
Well, it's a symbol of slavery, Jordan, because that pyramid was put together with slave labor. And on our dollar bill, this is the reverse seal. And if we take a look at the schematic of Washington, D.C., we see the layout.
Right, but it was also one of the greatest bricklaying projects the world has ever known. And bricklayers are referred to as brick masons. So it is a symbol of the Masonic orders of the world.
That makes sense.
And it is a very powerful symbol that has been used by the ancient secret societies. And I am here to tell you that that pyramid called Cheops Pyramid is a very important symbol. Something I wanted to bring out about this New World Order, because we said we want to explain it. Let me make this point, that Europe is referred to as the Old World, and anything coming from Europe is Old World. When you understand that Europe dominated the world for almost 1,600 years, the Vatican dominated Europe. The Vatican dominated the Old World Order. Those banking families that were Roman, Catholic banking families of Europe were the powers of the world. They dominated the world. With the coming of America, America becomes known as the New World. Remember, Columbus discovered a New World. When we hear the word New World Order, we're talking about a fraternal order of power, religion, money, operating out of the New World, America.
But a satanic, occultic, evil form of power.
The big picture? They want it all. They want to enslave your child, your wife, your mother. There isn't anything that you ever had. There isn't anything that you own. There isn't any right that you possess that they're not planning on taking away. They want it all. You've got a choice. You can join in this fight, or you can die as a slave.
When George Bush used this term, he used several other terms that along with this term, New World Order. He also said 1,000 points of light. He used another term, New Age. Another term, peace and safety. Jordan, who else in history has used this terminology?
Well, of course, all of the despots of history have used similar terminology, and it's always been the same concept of a total world domination. Go back to Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon, talking about how he had gathered all the peoples under him and how impressed he was with himself. You go down the line, and all of the great dictators and tyrants of the world have always dreamed of taking over the world. But everyone tried it the wrong way. Everyone has tried to take over the world with military, and everyone has discovered that military will not work. You cannot police and militarize enough to take over the world. So the Illuminati in 1776 developed a whole new concept of how to pull this project off. Instead of trying to force people into a new order or a totalitarian dictatorship under military, which you cannot do because people are always going to rebel at that, the idea was developed by Adam Weishaupt to create enough violence and create enough chaos and enough bloodshed to frighten the world, so that the entire world of mankind would one day come to the conclusion that there's too much bloodshed, too much crime, and there's just no possible way for the human race to exist unless we come together and pool our resources and all of us accept one government and one order, and we will all live together in peaceful, happy, on one family, and nothing could be further from the truth.
Are the Satanists involved in the New Age movement? Is the New Age movement really sort of a cover for this whole Luciferian conspiracy, in your opinion?
I wouldn't say it's a cover. I would say it's the integral part of it, you know, the spiritual heart of what you're talking about, you know, a New World Order. In fact, Alice Bailey, who coined the term New Age, who was a psychic and a channeler and an occultist, coined the term New Age and also coined the term New World Order. They both came from the same source. In her book, Externalization of the Hierarchy, she said that the New World Order would be based on the ancient wisdom or ancient occultism, which
now,
is where the term New Age came from.
Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky wrote a magazine. I've had the bound works of that magazine entitled Lucifer Magazine. She had a lot of followers. Adolf Hitler was one.
Mm-hmm.
He certainly incorporated a lot of the occult symbology.
Well, let me comment on that real quickly.
The Third Reich.
The term swastika, that is not a German term. The very name swastika is a Hindu word, and it's a symbol. Now, most people in the audience have probably never heard of this, but in occultism, it deals a lot with energies, with powers and forces, and these powers and forces come through something that are called chakras. And the word chakra is a Hindu word which means spinning vortex. Now, the swastika is a symbol of the chakras that are energized and working in unison. So the word swastika is a Hindu word, not a German word. And the word Aryan is a Hindu word. Now, it has nothing to do with ancient Germans. The Aryans were the Brahmin caste of Hinduism. So much of the terminology and concepts that Hitler used were from esoteric Hinduism and had nothing to do with, you know, ancient German culture or folklore at all.
I guess one of the...
In Millennium 2000.
Well, that's why one of the rock singers, I think it was Prince, that had the song, A Party Like It's 1999, because those who were in the know that something is coming for the year 2000, and most of the people are sound asleep and have no idea what's on its way. So that's why the song came out, Party Like It's 1999, because the LA Times had an article, all the major leaders of the world are going to meet at the base of the pyramid in 1999 to bring in what they call the Novus Ordo Seclorum, the new order of the world. There is so much more that needs to be said about this subject that we can never possibly get into, but there is something I really feel is necessary to bring out. We're not talking about something that's entertaining or sensational. We're talking about your government, where you live, your country, your freedoms.
Right.
And what we're talking about here is things which you see every day, like someone said a long time ago, many will look with their eyes but not see, and listen with their ears but not hear. And that's us. That is this country. We have been looking at things all along and never realizing the significance of the occult emblems that we're seeing today.
Okay. We're talking about a global government that's in existence right now. We're not talking about a nation that is going, we're talking about a nation that is gone. We do not control the government of the United States of America. The United States of America is controlled by this evilarchy. They control a money system, they control a State Department, they control a presidency. And if you take a look at the fasci on each side of the Speaker's podium in the Senate, you're going to find that we have a new world order in place. What do we have to do? Incite a revelation to avoid a revolution? Or wait for the second coming? The choice is up to you. The privately owned Federal Reserve is just that. It's private. It's not owned by you. The national debt is to the international banksters. Communism was never, well, run from the United States. Or was it? You got to stop and think about that for a moment. And when you really find out what's going down, you really find out what's going down at the bottom line, you'll discover that communism was never run from Moscow, Hanoi, or Peking. It was run from London, New York, and Washington, D.C. On the backside of the dollar bill, you'll find the Illuminati pyramid, Anahuac Septus. Novus Ordo Seclorum, the New World Order. What is all that about? I'm going to ask Jordan Maxwell. Jordan?
Yes, I will use this one I think would be better for. The Novus, let's start with the Anuit Coeptus. Anuit Coeptus is Latin, meaning our enterprise or our project is now a success, or has been crowned with success. So then you say, well, your project is now crowned with success. What is the project? Novus Ordo Seclorum, which is novus, meaning new, ordo, order, the new order. Seclorum is the word secular in Latin, meaning the world, the new order of the world. You will notice that there are 13 layers in the pyramid. There are 13 letters in Anuit Coeptus. There are 13 stars above the head of the eagle. There are 13 berries and 13 leaves. There are 13 arrows. There are 13 stripes. Everything is done in sequence of 13 except the wings, which are 32 and 33 for the 32nd degree and 33rd degree of Freemasonry. The 13 is said to be an unlucky number because it represents originally Jesus and the 12, because Jesus and the 12 are the basis for the world. And so this has been borrowed and used, and I think very cleverly. So it's an unlucky number, we're told, because you're not supposed to use it. To show you how this symbolism on the dollar bill is there's quite a bit of symbolism on the dollar bill here. I want to draw your attention to the right-hand side of the $1 bill at the top on the one. You'll see at the top, right here on the little curvature, if you look very closely, you will see an owl that you can. It is used as a symbol because it sees things in the dark. The little owl on the symbol on the dollar bill is to symbolize something the Bohemian Society, which is incidentally meeting this month up in San Francisco. The owl is a cult symbol used by the Bohemian Society and the Illuminati in general because it symbolizes that you can. It is used as a symbol because it sees things in the dark, and that's why it's wise, implying that our political leaders are seeing things in the dark. They are aware of many dark things which are going on, and that's why they're wise and you're not. So that's why they are the owls on the dollar.
It's important to bring up this particular point. The Bohemian Grove, and this is where all of the fellas meet and run around it in the forest nude, is where this new council for the President of the United States goes when he is on vacation. And his name is?
Yeah, well, all the presidents are
there.
No,
I'm talking about the new so-called Republican advisor to the President of the United States. And, of course, we found individuals like Ronald Reagan, Gerald Ford, Carter, all dressed in black robes, yes. Hooded robes, looking up and worshiping what?
The owl.
The owl
in front of a bonfire, a large bonfire. And incidentally, we have pictures of all of the American presidents. This has appeared in three different magazines, which I have color pictures of. All the American presidents standing around the bonfire in capes and pointed hats, like the Ku Klux Klan type of regalia.
Well, I'm a little confused.
Yes.
And maybe others are out there. Look. What is this Bohemian Society? Where are they located, and are they another subgroup of the Skull and Bones, the Illuminati, the Bilderbergers? I mean, all these other cults, they're just another subgroup then, right?
Yes, but this is a social group. This is a purely social get-together that they say they do not express business or discuss business.
Well, wait a minute, I don't think so. At a social group, you don't generally stand out in the woods dressed
in Ku Klux Klan
outfits. You know, worshiping the owl.
Yeah, in front of a bonfire. But there's a reason for that, because the fire is the fire of illumination. The fire is of the Illuminati. Of the Illuminati, of course.
And we're talking about Ronald Reagan, who so many conservatives supported. They used to call him Red Ronnie.
Absolutely. Ronald Reagan is a member of this organization, just as... And incidentally, in their own publication, they say that the reason they are called the Bohemian Society, because... a bohemian is someone, I'm roughly paraphrasing, someone who does not live by the same morals and ethics that the populace does. And so they're saying that the people who lead this country meet in private because they don't live by the same morals and ethics you do. They have a whole different standard of behavior than you do.
In Dr. Anthony Sutton's book, Wall Street and the Rise of Hitler, we find that the Bush family was heavily involved in financing Hitler, and the Kennedy family as well.
Right. Now, the point is, I want to continue with this. When you understand, we're talking about the Vatican, we're talking about Hitler and Mussolini. We're talking about the fascist of Europe in war with America and England. Now we're talking about the Empire Strikes Back. And as we said in the last program, New York is the Empire State. That's why you have Steven Spielberg and George Lucas movies talking about the Lost Ark. The Raiders of the Lost Ark, who was that, going for the Lost Ark with Indiana Jones, but Adolf Hitler. And in The Last Crusade, it's Adolf Hitler again. So
well,
what we're
Hollywood
talking
is
about
making
here,
figures not for the profit, but for the propaganda.
Yes. But you see, they know what they're saying. And as I brought out to you before, the old magic practicing priest of the of England, the old Celtic priests used to work their magic like Merlin the magician with his magic wand, and magic wands were always made out of Hollywood. So I'm saying that Hollywood has been used by, and that's why motion picture stars are called movie stars, because in the Bible stars were referred to as lesser illuminaries. So these lesser illuminaries are working for the big Illuminati.
So
the big Illuminati are using the lesser Illuminati. The lesser illuminaries are just stars.
So what you're saying, Jordan, is most of us are asleep.
We're
totally
asleep.
We're subtly being conditioned by a number of occultic organizations, occultic attacks, occultic conspirators to condition us into this.
Well, we are being awakened, really, to the New World Order. You take a look in like Time magazine. I'm going to bring it out again. You say you want a revolution, but are we willing to pay the price? They're talking, we don't want a revolution, we want a revelation. They say, who pays for Yasser Arafat? You know who pays for Yasser Arafat? Who gets Yasser Arafat's fat out of the fire? The United States government came over there to Lebanon when his back was against the sea. He would have been wiped out by the Israeli army. And the United States says no, 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 because they want to control this particular conflict. They brought up U.S. troops and U.S. ships to get Yasser Arafat's fat out of the fire and bring him over to Libya because they wanted him alive, because they want a controlled conflict. The same thing is happening in South Central Los Angeles. The same thing is happening in major cities throughout the United States and throughout the world. This is conflict control, and the symbols are everywhere.
That is precisely what has been happening for the last 100 years. The Illuminati have been purposely organizing, directing, and financing wars, revolutions, violence, and bloodshed so that it will sufficiently impress and frighten the world of humanity into accepting a new order, a new police state that will finally put down all the law and order, the disorder in the world. And it is the oldest trick in the book. Well, our greatest enemy is not in a crack house, it's in the White House. It's not in a bar room, it's in the boardrooms. And so the point I'm making is that we are being manipulated from the very top, and we need to wake up and find out that America is not the land of the free and the home of the brave, because we're not free,
any longer.
We darn sure ain't brave.
Any longer.
Right. One point here in relation to what he says. We're not talking about an evil genius somewhere in Bavaria. We're talking about America. Here is the new world order. We are in the middle of the most diabolical, conspiratorial movement ever developed on the face of the earth, right here in America.
The Illuminati came to the United States through a fraternity, a Faustian financial fraternity, in 1832. And if we take a look at this Faustian financial fraternity, we will see that we have the skull and bones, and we see a little 32. Underneath the symbol. Now, George Bush was in there. William Buckley Jr., who would talk in very Edwardian tones. I asked Bill Buckley about his membership in the Skull and Bones in New Orleans.
Say?
He got up and almost went running out of the room.
He refused to even comment.
George Bundy. I addressed this to George Bundy. He just came completely discombobulated on the stage. I wish I had a picture of that
event. George Bush was asked one time, and he changed the subject.
Of course.
So
that's what it's all about.
We're talking about our national leaders.
Big bombs. Please welcome Mr. Bill Gates. We also face a new threat that the next epidemic has a good chance of originating on a computer screen of a terrorist intent on using genetic engineering to create a synthetic version of the smallpox virus or a contagious and highly deadly strain of flu. So the point is that we ignore the strong link between health security and international security at our peril. Whether it occurs by the quirk of nature or at the hand of a terrorist, epidemiologists show through their models that a respiratory spread pathogen would kill more than 30 million people in less than a year. And there is a reasonable probability of that taking place in the years ahead. This is also where we see many epidemics starting. For example, Ebola.